Before we come to how you became a lawyer, there's this rumor going about when we were young boys that you were actually a cowboy. I mean, during your early age, and you went and stood by a school and were listening to whatever the teacher was teaching the students. And from there, you started answering questions. And this teacher actually came to your father to plead that they should send you to school.
No, no, that is not true. You know, at the beginning, I told you that I went to school late. So, yes, I was a shepherd boy. Because if you, at that time, if you were not going to school, I was my father's beloved son. He wanted me to take after him as a successful farmer. So I was going to farm with him. I was going to collect termites for the chickens and so on, the chicks. I was taking the goats and, the sheep out and cattle and so on. Then two things influenced me to go to the school. The school uniform was made up of this khaki, some braces. You cross at the back, cross and come and put.
Yeah, remember.
Yes, I admired that very much. So I wanted to wear one of them. That was one of the motivations for going to the school. Then also, the one who I said, you know, wrote those posters in Navrongo School.
Yes.
Yes, he had started school earlier that year. There's one who is retired now, and he's at Timonde right now. He had started 2 years before. There was another one who has started 1 year before. All in our enclave in Timonde there.
They were your friends too?
No, my family members.
Okay. Who have
Timonde were a small, we are family.
Okay.
There are a few settlers, but basically were one man's children who have settled there. So I was interested in going to school. I wasn't, it's not true that I went to go and listen. I was interested in going to school, to go with them. And then my cousin's wife, my father's elder brother's son, he started down south and married some lady, and they came home. So they were one of the most enlightened group pair in Timonde there. And this woman, my brother's wife, so she was very fond of me. Night used to separate us. So I discussed this idea of going to school with her. And she said, yes, you will do well in school. And my father was dead against, not to talk about my mother, because they saw school to be a place for suffering. My mother could, when I went, she could, for 1 week, she couldn't eat.
Because you said you were going to school?
No, because I went.
Oh, okay.
I went. So I plotted or strategized with this, my cousin's wife. She said, look, this man, we won't allow you to go. So you just have to get up and go there. If you go there and they write your name in the register, it will be difficult for him to come and reverse it. So I strategized with her. My father went somewhere. And she used her, I had to use her dress. I had to wear her dress like a lady. Then she passed me over the wall. And I took off. I went and joined my friends around the riverside on the way to Tanga. And I got there. And then Dr. Asana, who died recently, his father was the head teacher of Tanga Primary School.
Okay.
Fantastic man. He really gave us a solid foundation. So he took me and registered me. And he was teaching P1. People. So he was my number one teacher, my first teacher. So then my father returned from wherever he went and asked for me. My mother said she didn't know where I'd passed. My mother's younger sister too had married my father. In those days they used to do that. She too said she didn't know. I was here, and then they asked my cousin's wife. She too pretended that she didn't know where I had passed, but I was just around here. Then something said told this man that my father that I must have gone to school at Tanga. So he took his lenga and
trace you.
And came to the school, started quarreling with everybody. That time we had overseers. There was an overseer from Tanga area there. Hmm. And the school was in Gunga. That area of Tanga is called Gunga, where the Mampuses were.
Yeah.
So they had a standpipe because they were chiefs at that time. There was a standpipe there, a borehole. Those days very rare, but there was one there. And every morning when we got to the school, they would take all of us to that standpipe. And that caretaker would bath us before we go back to school. Because when we left the house, nobody had time to bath. We were not used to bathing. So they would send us by force to the pipe and wash us. So, and my father knew him because my mother was related to him. So he got there and he demanded to see him. He was called Ayadawo, Abambiliadawo. Abambiliadawo Beya. Then the man appeared. He said, my son has come here. I want to take him back home. I'm taking him back home. So the man, this caretaker, where was his authority to give me to back to him? So he came to tell the head teacher, Asana's father, that this person you have just registered, his father has come and is making a lot of commotion in the school. So the head teacher called him to his office. Said, this boy is going to do good for you in future. He said, no. He doesn't want that. He should cancel my name and he will take me home. So the head teacher said, there's no way I'll cancel his name and you take him home. You go, he will come home. So he couldn't do, he knocked himself about, then he returned. When he got to Timone, he went to the chief's house. He went to report the teacher to the chief. That was the first Kusasi chief of Timone, Akarim. And I called Akarim my grandfather. So Akarim asked him that, so that boy who has gone to the school, you say he is your what? That is his son. But you are my what? That I am your son. So I am big man over you and your son, the child. So you know they have come and they are telling us chiefs that we should let the children go to school. And you are not sending the person to school. Now the person has got up himself and gone. He has helped you and you are saying that you cannot go and take him. If you go to the school again and they demand that they should give the boy to you, I will deal with you as my son. So go. So the chief sacked him. I came home, there was war in the house. My mother was weeping, no, couldn't eat. But me and my wife, my cousin's wife, we were discussing privately and not minding them. That's how I went to school.
Okay, so we understand that from primary one, you were jumped to primary three.
It is not true. In primary school, I did all the 6 years, but I was an outstanding student or people. So they gave me all sorts of, they could take me from P2 to go and teach people in P4. In the middle school, when I got there, the head teacher was doing that and earned a lot of hatred for me. I would write an essay and he would take it to Form 4 and read it. That is how we write English. And that is, I owe that to Dr. Asana's father. He taught us real English. That's why people of our age from that school, we speak reasonably good English. So it is not true, many of these fairy tales.
Okay.
I was there, I went to P1, P2, P2. P3, P4, and most of the teachers were from down south.
Okay.
And they were people teachers. Many of them, they were people teachers, and they were mostly from down south. So, and they taught us very well. It is in, the jump took place in Form 1, because that means I could have gone to secondary school either from 2 or from 3 or from 4. So people, most people went to secondary school at form 4, mm-hmm. after form 4. Mm-hmm. They would go to secondary school just as they are about to take the middle school leaving certificate examination. So if you consider that, it means I was jumped 3 years. Mm-hmm. I went to secondary school after form 1, which was not the normal practice. That is the only jump I had.
So from 1 you wrote?
From 1 I went to Nabrongo Secondary School. Yes.
Okay. So how did you become a lawyer?
No, when I came back from Nigeria, I was made the secretary for Northern Region. Then I assumed office, as I said, 8th February 1982. Then in November 1982, there was a reshuffle. The person who was put at Bolga as upper regional secretary was Dr. Tinoga, a medical officer. He was 1 year behind me at Nabrongo School. And he was somebody Rawlings liked. I think they had been having some interaction because through Chris Atim again. So he told Rawlings that he didn't want to get too much involved in this revolution business. But because of the exigencies of the situation, he was prepared to hold the fort at Bolga there for 6 months, and he would go back to his medical practice. So in November, they had to do a reshuffle to take account of this. So that's how they moved me to Bolga here as upper regional minister, secretary or minister. Before the split to Upper East, Upper West. So, and then Tinoga left. And then Hudu Yahya became
acting Northern Regional Secretary
and later on Substantive Secretary. So I came to Bolga in November 1982. And I was there till February 1984. You know, somewhere in 83, he split the region into two, Upper East, Upper West. And all these things, I don't do these things to take any credit. But for me, that region wouldn't have been created. And I had made up my mind when we were having problems with Achampong. The intelligence people were chasing me up and down. I was in Tamale, and Hawa Yakubu managed to get in touch with me at Tamale and told me that they were looking for me in Bolga, and I should check my movements, you know. But they used to pass me like this without knowing that I was the person. The intelligence people, they didn't know me. I wasn't getting close to them. So I was only, you know, on radio and, you know, in issuing statements and so on, BBC in particular. So the old person, one time I was going from Bolga to Tamale, and they, Hawa warned me that they would take me on the way. So I had to change my route. Rather, I was coming from Tamale to Bolga, and Hawa warned me that they would pick me somewhere.
Hawa Yakubu.
Yes.
Okay.
So I diverted and went to Madame's brother that I say became MP. He was teaching at Jirapa Senior High School now, the girls' school.
Went to Upper West.
So I went there.